be tempted to throw it at you on stage, so.
I got a couple, I'll throw them back. At him.
Thank you. invite you to rise for our opening song. Good morning. Welcome to Amazing Grace Lutheran Church. My name is Pastor Susanna. If you're visiting with us today, we're so glad that you're here. If you are with us on YouTube, either live or on the video, we are glad that you are with us as well. If you are joining us on YouTube, please remember to hit that like button, hit subscribe, and ring the notification bell. That really helps YouTube's artificial intelligence algorithm suggests our videos to other people. So it's a great way to evangelize. If you are here today, please know that we believe and teach that we come to God's table by grace and not by right. So if you are worshiping with us, you are welcome to receive communion with us, and we will explain more about that in a minute. And you may notice that there are a number of people in church today who are wearing green or shades of green or shades of blue-green, and we even have green up on the altar, and my book is green. We are marking Mental Health Awareness Month today. And so all of the readings were chosen and all of the songs were chosen to reflect the idea that we want to destigmatize mental health and that Jesus is with us all in our journey toward full health, both physical and mental. There is a maroon pad in each row of seats, and I invite you to fill that out sometime during the service. That lets us know who was here, and it lets us know if we need to contact you for any reason. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with a song.
Know this. The Lord is God, our Maker to whom we belong.
We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture.
Enter into the gates of the Lord with thanksgiving. Go into God's courts with praise.
Give thanks to God and bless
For the Lord is good. God's steadfast love is everlasting.
God's faithfulness endures from age to age.
Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share that peace in a way that feels safe to us. We can wave, we can do the peace sign, do a fist bump, elbow bump. Peace be with you. Wave to the people on YouTube. We're glad you're with us too. Peace be with you all. And let us pray. Lord Christ, you came into the world as one of us and suffered as we do. As we go through the trials of life, help us to realize that you are with us at all times and in all things, that we have no secrets from you, and that your loving grace enfolds us for eternity. In the security of your embrace, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. We are actually going to send any kids we have with Miss Joanne to Sunday school right now, and you will get a chance to show us what you made in Sunday school later. So there's Miss Joanne right there, Alexa. All right, and I invite the reader to come up. Good morning.
First reading comes from Jonah, chapter 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish, saying, I called to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. You cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight. How shall I look again upon your holy temple? The waters closed in over me, and deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped around my head at the foots of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought up my life from the pit. O Lord, my God, as my life was ebbing away, I remembered the Lord, and prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who worship vain idols forsake their true loyalty. But I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you what I have vowed I will pay. Deliverance belongs to the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to the fish, and it spewed Jonah out upon the dry land. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsively Psalm 42. As a deer longs for flowing streams, so my soul longs for you, O God.
My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and behold the face of God?
My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me continually, where is your God?
These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I went with the throng.
And led them in procession to the house of God, with glad shouts and songs of thanksgiving, a multitude keeping festival.
Why are you cast down, my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Holy God, for I shall again praise you. My help and my God. My
soul is cast down within me. Therefore, I remember you from the lands of Jordan and of Hermon from Mount Mizar.
He calls to thee at the thunder of your cataracts. All your waves and your billows have gone over me.
By day, the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night, his song is with me. A prayer to the God of my life.
I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I walk about mournfully? Because the enemy oppresses me.
As with a deadly wound in my body, my adversaries taunt me, while they say to me continually, where is your God?
Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God.
When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On the very day their plans perish.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Oh, okay. Our New Testament reading comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God that is in Corinth, including all the saints through Achaia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation, who consoles us in our affliction, so that we may be able to console those who are in any affliction with the consolation with which we ourselves are consoled by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are abundant for us, so also are consolations in abundance through Christ. If we are being afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation. If we are being consoled, it is for your consolation, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we all also suffer. Our hope for you is unshaken, for we know that as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our consolation. We do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, of the affliction we experienced in Asia, for we were so utterly, unbearably crushed that we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death, so that we would rely not on ourselves but on God who raises the dead. He who rescued us from so deadly a peril will continue to rescue us. On him we have set our hope that he will rescue us again, as you also join in helping us by your prayers, so that many will give thanks on our behalf for the blessing granted to us through the prayers of many. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. When Jesus came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." He went down to Capernaum, a city in Galilee, and was teaching them on the Sabbath. They were astounded at his teaching because he spoke with authority. In the synagogue, there was a man who had the spirit of an unclean demon. And the demon cried out with a loud voice, "Let us alone! What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked the demon, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." When the demon had thrown him down before them, he came out of him without having done any harm. They were all amazed and kept saying to another, "What kind of utterance is this? For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and out they come." And a report about him began to reach every place in the region. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Beloved in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. I've just returned from 2 days at the Synod Assembly up in Port Huron. Rosalyn was with me, Susan Sunderman, who can't be here today, and Elspeth Muzzin, who can't be here today, were also with me. And Elspeth has volunteered to give a report on the assembly next week. But what you should know is that we have elected a bishop. Bishop Chris was reelected for his third term, and we're very glad about that, at least I am. And during the assembly, we heard and talked a great deal about the importance of telling stories. Stories of our lives and the lives of others, stories of Jesus, stories of healing, stories of loss, stories of redemption. So I want to start today by telling you a story about a young woman that I once knew very well, and I have her permission to tell the story. She was someone who worked hard in school, and she tried to be a good person. She went to church, she participated in the youth group, she loved Jesus, but she worried. She worried a lot. She worried about her mom because her parents were divorced, and her mom was often very stressed trying to raise kids on her own. She worried about her brother, who was falling in with a bad crowd and was using drugs and alcohol at an early age. She worried about her grades, and she worried about whether or not she was popular, and she worried about whether she'd said the wrong thing in class. Sometimes it seemed like she couldn't get those worries out of her head. And as her teen years progressed, her worries took a new and darker form. Her worries about ordinary things, like whether the stone or the iron had been turned off, ramped up into overdrive. It was like she could not get certain thoughts out of her head. She spent one entire Christmas vacation when they were away calling her house over and over again. She knew it was empty, and she knew no one would answer, but she reasoned that if the phone rang, that meant the stove had not been left on and the house had not burned down. She was ashamed of these obsessions, and she was afraid to tell anyone about them, so she kept them secret and hidden, and they ate her up inside. One time, when she was in college, she happened to read about a TV anchor woman in the early 1970s who had taken her own life on the air. And she began to obsess nonstop about suicide and about hurting other people. Would she commit suicide or try to hurt herself? Would she ever hurt someone else? She'd never ever tried to do it or even wanted to do it. But the thought that she might do it plagued her. Everywhere she went, she obsessed over it. She could not stop thinking about it. It was the first thing in her mind in the morning and the last thing in her mind at night. And other obsessions, too many to describe, followed this one, crowding into her brain, causing her to try to write out her anxiety in scribbles, or say prayers nonstop, or count a certain number of times over and over again. She was in a kind of hell, a hell of intrusive thoughts and obsessions, a hell she could not escape, not ever. That young woman was me. Although I did not have the words for it at the time, I was suffering from something called OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. You'll hear people joke about it sometimes, but it was no joke for me. It was deadly serious. If I saw a horrible news story or picture, I could not get it out of my head, sometimes for days or for weeks. We have new words now to describe this process. We talk about how people have triggers and how these triggers can unleash the floodgates of intrusive thoughts and obsessions. And I'm so grateful that we now have language to describe what I felt. People with OCD are almost never a danger to themselves or others, but they worry that they are. They worry that they might help hurt themselves or somebody else. They obsess over it. They come up with elaborate compulsions, often involving counting, to counteract the obsessions. If I pace back and forth exactly 7 times, then I can forget the obsessions. But usually it doesn't work. And usually you cannot remember if you check the oven at all, no matter how many times you were supposed to check it. You repeat it over and over and over again, but you can never be sure. And it's sometimes called the doubting disease, because you begin to doubt everything. Did I just check the iron? How do I know I checked the iron? And so on and on and on and on. OCD is a type of anxiety disorder. And I was fortunate that I experienced at the time that huge advances were being made in medical and psychiatric science. There were several things in particular that helped me. First, I read a book by an eminent psychiatrist called The Doctor and the Soul. It was by Viktor Frankl. He was a Holocaust survivor. And he worked with patients with many different mental and emotional ailments, including OCD. He developed a process called paradoxical thinking, which is a way to trick your brain. Instead of fighting the obsession and trying not to think about it because that gives it power, paradoxically, you try to think about it. And what happens almost magically is that the obsession and with it the shame loses its power and fades away. It's really kind of a miracle. And therapy also helped. I did 5 years of once-a-week meetings with a therapist to work through my feelings of shame and feelings of lack of worth. Praying and seeking help from pastors was also more help than I can say. One time during a particularly bad spell, I was on a trip to England with my family, and we were visiting Ely Cathedral. I wrote down an anonymous prayer request about my obsessions, and I left it in the prayer box. I was dumbfounded just half an hour later during evening prayer when the priest said a prayer for those suffering from mental health as he was holding my prayer request in his hand. He had read it. I know that's what he was supposed to do, but I felt seen and heard, not only by the church, but by God. And finally, for me, medication was a game changer. I had to experiment with several different kinds before I found the right fit, but I've been taking a low dose of that medication for many, many years now, and the symptoms are basically zero. I don't feel drugged. I feel like myself. Now, why am I telling you all this? For several reasons. First, mental health issues are an epidemic in our world, especially after the pandemic. And we can't do anything about this epidemic if we don't acknowledge it, demystify it, and destigmatize it. I was not a bad person for having this condition. I had done nothing to deserve it or to bring it on. But there it was. Pretending it wasn't and trying to keep it hidden did absolutely zero good. My grandmother, the nurse, always said that sunlight and fresh air are the best medicine. So I want to model that we can talk about these things without shame and embarrassment. And another reason for telling you all this is to let you know that you are not alone. Some of you, perhaps many of you, have also suffered from anxiety or addiction or bipolar or depression or OCD or paranoia or delusions or something else. I have not experienced all of those things, but I definitely know what it's like to suffer internally while you're trying to put on a brave face for the rest of the world. Almost nobody knew that I suffered as I did. I trusted only my mother, my husband, my therapist, and my pastor, and eventually my daughter. I want you to know that if you need to speak to someone, you can start with me with no shame and no embarrassment. I am not a therapist, and I will refer you to a therapist. But I can listen and help with the spiritual dimension of mental illness to let you know that no matter what's happening in your mind, you are not alone. God is with you. And another reason that I'm talking about this is this. It's important that we in the church lead the charge in mental health awareness. Why? Because Jesus did. Look at our story today. First, Jesus goes into the synagogue and declares that he is there to set the captives free and to loose the bonds of the oppressed. And by that he means not only those literally in prison and not only those who are physically ill, but also those of us who are captive to emotional and mental turmoil. And to demonstrate this, in his very next action, he goes into another synagogue and heals a young man with a demon. Now, today we might say that this young man suffered from delusions or was having a psychotic breakdown. It really doesn't matter what words we use to name it. What matters is that Jesus healed him. And how did he heal him? Notice what he did. First, he did not turn away. He did not pretend not to see. He did not leave. Instead, he stayed with the man. Second, he knew that the man was not the disease. I feel this very keenly because my OCD felt like something foreign had come into my brain to torture me. Now, I didn't believe it was a demon. I knew that it was my brain chemicals that were misaligned and out of whack so that certain thoughts became obsessive. And the reason I continue to take my daily anti-anxiety medication is because it makes me feel more like myself, not less. It gives me back myself. So my illness was not me. And Jesus knows the same thing. The man is not the same as his illness or his demon. The man is a beloved child of God. He might be regarded by other humans and by society as unclean, but to God he is not unclean, not shameful, not dirty, not broken, not worthy of contempt, not discardable. To God, to Jesus, this man is beloved. This man is worthy of living life and living it abundantly. And so Jesus speaks not to the man, but to the illness, to the demon. And he says, be silent and come out of him. To someone who suffered from intrusive, obsessive thoughts, that command to the demon to be silent really resonates. I longed for silence in my brain. And because Jesus is God incarnate, the demon leaves. And the man is whole again. He is made whole again. He was sick, but despite his sickness, God saw him as he was created to be, a whole, joyful, living person. The sickness was not him. It's one of the reasons I hate to say about someone, he's sick, with utter contempt. Because if it's a sickness, then that's not who the person really is. If you have cancer, you are not the cancer. If you have a mental illness, you are not the mental illness. And finally, I want to add this. At the time, I would have given almost anything to relive my life so I never had those horrible intrusive thoughts. They were that painful. But I wouldn't do that now. Because my experience has made me recognize how Jesus accompanies others in their pain, how Jesus was with me all the time, and how we can do the same. God does not cause evil, but God can always bring good out of evil. And that's what happened to me. Because of my illness, I was a more compassionate mother and wife and daughter, friend, teacher, and pastor. Because of my illness, I met Jesus where I was, and I was able to follow him. Without my illness, although my illness was not me, without my illness, I would not be who I am today. Now, my story is not everybody's story. There are mental health issues far more serious than mine. And I don't mean to say that all you need to do is read a book and talk to a pastor and take a pill. But God is with you in the journey, and we in the church are with you as well. The journey is hard, but we in the church have a mission from God to look at all our siblings in Christ, all of whom are beloved with the eyes of Jesus, to walk with them as Jesus walked with Mary Magdalene, out of whom he cast seven spirits, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, to follow Jesus and offer to him our whole selves, knowing that our illness is not ourselves and that Jesus sees who we truly are. Offering to him the illness and the pain and the suffering so that they too will be redeemed. Amen. Thank you. So much. Our next song is new to us, but it really fits. It's Jesus saying, "You are mine no matter what." And we heard Roz playing it during the prelude, so the tune will sound familiar. I'm a teacher. I believe we can learn new things. So we are going to learn this song because it is beautiful. Please rise as you are able.
Thank you.
faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the prayers. United in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of harmony, as you drew your Son to your side, you draw us to you and unite us with the planet and one another. Weave your church together in a web of mutual love for the sake of the world. Lord, in your mercy. As your Spirit hovered over the waters of creation, so your Spirit hovers over all that you have made. Bless the water that sustains the planet and grant wisdom to use it wisely. Lord, in your mercy. You empower your people with the fire of your Spirit. Challenge activities and activists and organizers, teachers and politicians, and all in leadership to speak a message of peace and justice. Lord, in your mercy. You care for all your children. Show your steadfast love to those suffering isolation, especially exiles, refugees, or prisoners. Break the chains of all held fast by oppression of any kind. Comfort and heal all those who are afraid or suffering from mental or physical illness, especially Julie Ambrose, Dan Brunette, Douglas Berger, Colleen Chimelko, Dan Kosnick, Tom Dryden, Maria Dupliaha, Debbie Emmons, Nancy Engelin, Larry Gentry, Diana Gilbert, Ed Harm, Sue Hewitt, Miranda Holmes, Angie and Wally Kenmuir, Nancy Kenmuir, Carol Cook, Brendan Kowalski, Roger Lamoth, the Lohr family, Laura Lesniak, John and Vinnie D-Man, Marilyn McQueen, Trish McMinn, Nancy Meissner, Deborah Nelson, the O'Neill family, Debbie Palmer, Bruce Polzinski, Bob and Barb Potter, Sheila Roberts, Deanna Robinson, Karen Rothenhauser, Pat Rowley, Kensington Schumann, Joyce Stearns Thompson, Mary Stevick, Sharon Sunderman, Kathy Truscott, Jennifer, Julie Kay, Victoria, Marie, and those we name aloud or in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, we give thanks that humankind serves as your body in the world, stewarding your abundant gifts. Guide this congregation's leaders as they seek your will. We pray for our staff and council and those in positions of leadership. Lord, in your mercy, you raise your saints to new life in Christ. We give you thanks for all your saints who have given us glimpses of your redeeming love. Comfort those who mourn, especially the Booker, Vinstra, Roberts, Lohr, Ennis, Rowley, Bell, and Kayer families. Lord, in your mercy. Rejoicing in the power of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Let us with gladness present the offerings of our life and labor to the Lord. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. We'll sing, "I'm so glad Jesus lifted me," as we bring our offerings forward. Beloved, if you choose to use one of our communion kits today, please hold that in your hands as we pray. And if you need a communion kit, please raise your hands and an usher will bring one to you. As we come forward for communion, if you choose to come forward, you can take bread, and then we have both wine and juice in the trays. Wine is red, juice is clear. And I invite you to rise as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to all, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all creation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come and know Christ, broken, poured out, and raised for you. Amen. You may be seated. If you are using a communion kit, as you take the bread, this is the body of Christ given for you. And as you take the wine or the juice, this is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in you we live and move and have our being. With your word and this meal of grace, you have nourished our life together. Strengthen us to show your love and serve the world in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And the God of all who raised Jesus from the dead, bless you by the power of the Holy Spirit to live in the new creation. Amen.
Amen.
All right, several announcements. First of all, Bible study this Wednesday at 10 a.m. You can join us in person here at the church, or you can join us on Zoom. And we send out the Zoom notification with the link on Wednesday morning. So we look forward to having you there. We're reading through the mighty Acts of the Book of Acts. And I just want to thank you all for showing your support. I want to thank Cindy Lohr for suggesting that we do a Mental Health Awareness Day. I think that this was a wonderful opportunity to show our support and our desire to destigmatize and simply deal with illness as illness, that we can work, but we don't need to be ashamed, we don't need to be embarrassed, we don't need to be afraid. So thank you all. Thank you, Cindy. Cindy has brought in a number of resources that are out on a green table, and I think green is chosen because green is the color of new life. That's my guess, right? And so out on a green table in the narthex, there are bookmarks, there are bracelets that you can wear, ribbons, green ribbons, posters, other sorts of things, magnets. So take a look. Oh, stress balls too. Gosh, I love a good stress ball. So take one of those and, just remember that we are destigmatizing, that we are sharing our stories, and that we are loving each other as Jesus loves all of us. Pentecost is next Sunday. So next Sunday, wear red to show your support. Last call for anyone who can read or speak a different language, see Pete Fisher or see me, and I will call on the usual suspects. So if you've done it before, which includes people in my family, I will call on you, and we will have our traditional reading of part of the lesson in other languages. And Vacation Bible School, can you believe it's almost time for that? Thanks to Joanne. Joanne, thinking about this, what we are going to do this year is based on fruits of the Spirit. It will be a multi-generational Vacation Bible School. We have a Wednesday evening, one Wednesday evening in June, one in July, one in August. We will have a meal together, maybe a cookout together. There will be activities for kids. Chance for grown-ups just to get together and talk with each other, share fellowship with each other. We'll do some stuff together, some stuff apart. So we really hope that you will join us. Food, fun, and fruit. please sign up in the narthex. Pete, do we have that sign up sheet up? Great. So sign up just so that we know numbers. So June 21st, July 19th, August 16th should be a whole lot of fun. And if you are joining us virtually for worship, we invite you always to come and worship with us in person when it feels safe to you and when you are in the area. And we thank you for joining us virtually. Are there other announcements? Denise.
Yeah, so now I can do what I want. I just wanted to verbally say to you that 2 weeks ago, the worship service and the retirement party you guys all gave for me, it touched me more than you would ever know. And I just loved having all my church family there and my family, and it was just the most special day to me. And it was so full of surprises. I mean, I think I knew it was happening, But I had no idea everything. I didn't know Kevin was going to come in pink pants and shoes and shirt and all the rest of you, and it was so festive. But I also wanted to thank the organizational team, the people who organized it, which my understanding were Elaine Dalton, she's out in the narthex, Lucille, Joanne.
Where's Joanne? Joanne's right, right there. Here. Yep.
Wally Kenmere, Pastor, and Pete. And am I missing anybody?
Nope, I think that.
If so, I think that was the basic. I mean, I know you all had a big part of it, and you just came and attended and supported it. So thank you so much for that. And I also want to thank Rosalind and Jeannie and the choir. The music was just beautiful, and it just, anything, I mean, you're perfect. So thank you. Thank you. And that is just a day that I will never forget, and you're always going to be my church family, and I'm always going to be here, and I just love you all so much, and I just want to really thank you from the bottom of my heart, because it was a very special, fun. I had so many compliments on it. We got some great pictures, and it just was a special day, so thank you. Love you.
All right, anybody else? Yes, Tom.
Morning.
Good morning.
First of all, next week, next Sunday, we're going to be wearing red, but Kevin, could you kind of... We had, this past Thursday, we cleaned up the grounds around the church. I tried to cut the snowball factory down, but as Pete very well noticed, the dandelions have a habit of ducking when you go by with the mower. And so even though I made my best effort to go as fast as I could before they could duck, they still stood up. The Boy Scouts were here, in the amount of energy they gave us this past week. And not only the Boy Scouts, their leaders and some of their parents were here. We had seven people from Amazing Grace out there working, the usuals, and there was just so much work that got done. I was, a couple times when I was talking to Kevin, I just looked around and I was really impressed by how much everybody was doing. This is a lot of ground to cover. If you get out there and walk around it with a weed whacker, you know how big it is. Right, Kevin?
Yeah.
Yes.
So we've got a great group of scouts here, and I think we complement each other well.
It's a blessing to have them. I contacted the scout master. He's going to contact Mount Calvary. They've got some privacy fencing that's getting really old and starting to fall down. He's going to go over and look at it. They're talking about going over there with a group of the boys and taking it down and piling it up for them. Which is just shows that these guys just don't quit. We have an election coming up, and as you will notice in the grace notes, if anybody wants to consider being on the council, we're looking for somebody to be on the council. Joanne's running for treasurer again, and Nancy is vice president, but we need some people for the at-large position. And then we have a group put together to talk to anybody who says that they'd like to participate in this. So if you want to, you can talk to me or the pastor, and or even Pete. He's around here all the time. So and we can leave Denise in retirement for right now because Pete's doing an outstanding job. So. He went out and worked out in the yard, which we couldn't get Denise to do. So the guy just doesn't stop. I have to every once in a while remind him that you don't want to keep doing everything because you're going to burn yourself out. But he said he knows his limits, but we're really grateful. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Great.
Can you explain what the at-large person does?
Okay. At-large is a general counsel position. We have the president, vice president, treasurer, and secretary, and the pastor. She's not willing to give up her position on the council. So, and I'm kind of enjoying living the lush life on my paycheck. But the at-large position is just, you're a part of the council, a voting member of the council, but you don't have a specific title like president, vice president, treasurer. And that's what we're looking for, is basically to get input from somebody who's not on the council. We didn't run out of ideas yet, but it's always nice to have a new voice come in with some new ideas that help us consider things we may not have considered before.
Right, exactly. Just another voice from the congregation.
Another voice. Well, not just another voice. They're all important. So that's all it is.
Awesome. Thank you. And then Joanne did... do we have anything to show, or?
She was so excited to have the healing of our butterflies that she passed them out to
some. Okay, excellent. Okay, well. Yeah, just so you know, our Sunday school student made butterflies today as a sign that Jesus always brings new life and changes us from the cocoon to the butterfly. So, all right. All right, please rise for our, don't pay attention to me.
That's okay.
We're not replacing you on the council.
Hold on.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Share the good news.
Amen.